Builder is the king of creational patterns, and kings don't do regular work. They do what others cannot. When it comes to creating complex graphs of objects with components tangled together with complicated rules, we call for a builder. In this video, I will show you one such complicated case in a realistic ASP.NET Core application. You will learn how to encapsulate complicated creation rules, the process, into a class so that the caller, the portion of code that needs that complicated logic, is eventually reduced to a single expression. Does that sound like magic to you? Let it be magic then. Stay with me and I will make you a magician with this builder implementation. This is the demo application modeling a bookstore. These are the books that people can buy. And these are the recent invoices we issued. Some people are still owing us money. We want to know who owes us how much. And here is the quick report on overdue payments. Now, this is the portion of code where we will need to implement a complicated feature. So pay attention to this. Look at this guy, Jake. He owes us $273. Let's see. Here is $119 long past due. Another $153 past due. That is $273. But there is also an $87 outstanding payment that is not past the tolerance days. We still don't panic about this invoice, but it exists. That should also be included in some report. So this is the page that should display the report with delinquent customers, including their long outstanding dues. Let's get to code. This is the model class behind that view. This is the getActionHandler. It is fetching unpaid invoices, and now it must prepare that report. This is the query that is fetching the data from the database. I must make a note here. This query doesn't belong here. This is the view model class. It really shouldn't be querying the database directly. I have added this code only for demonstration purposes so that you can see the entire process, what happens. This query shows you how the data are being shaped. And these are the records from the database. Now, when the rows are fetched from the database, they are converted to the domain model. There is the abstract invoice, which is only tracking basic information like customer, items, issue time, and so on. And it can either be a paid or unpaid invoice. The paid invoice brings payment time, and unpaid, which is also abstract, has due date. If you just queried the database day after day after day, the same invoice would change its runtime type when loaded from open over outstanding to overdue. The result is that we have a sequence of invoice domain models. And we need to build that report. Funny that I said build. It will be the builder's duty. That process should construct a sequence of customer delinquency objects. Each one is associated to a single customer. And it consists of multiple items. Those are the items that explain what kinds of payments the customer is due. And these are the possible items. I'm simulating a discriminated union with these records. The delinquent item is either an unpaid invoice, or interest on late payment, or one-time fee for issuing the warning to the customer. Now, if you thought, just for a moment, that you could take those unpaid invoices and calculate the dues there in the view or in some small class, utility function or something, then you should hear the requirements first. Here they come. Only unpaid invoices appear in any customer delinquency line. Interest only applies past the due date of an unpaid invoice. Only one interest line appears in a single customer's report, even if the customer has multiple unpaid invoices. One warning fee applies to a single customer's report, and both interest and warning fee are optional. We can choose even not to apply them if we wanted. More specific order of items. Interest only applies to invoices past due, and the fee only applies if there is at least one delinquent invoice. Are you following all these requirements? Each element of the delinquency report for a single customer has its own due date. That is at least a dozen of business rules to implement. Now again, will you add a utility function which does that? Well, good luck with that. So when I said I will build the report, I was not kidding. I will implement a separate class, call it the builder, and let that class manage all these requirements, all these customers' requirements. This is the builder that will deal with those requirements. It will expose methods in terms of the process I have just explained to you. Like adding an unpaid invoice, we will add one after another the unpaid invoices and expect the builder to stack them up according to those rules. Or specify the interest rate. The caller can pick the interest rate from any settings it has and specify it to the builder. This call is optional. If the user doesn't make a call to this method, then there will be no interest. That is the protocol. The same goes with notification fee. You can add more options to this builder if somebody asked for them, like requesting all customers to appear even if they don't have delinquent invoices, but they do have outstanding or unpaid invoices. When everything is done with the protocol, then expose the build method. That method will return the product of this builder. In this case, that will be the sequence of customer delinquency objects according to the rules. Sometimes you will add the Boolean can build method so that the caller can check if it is illegal to call build. Build might throw an exception from a builder that contains incomplete information for its product. We don't need that. If nothing was called, if nothing was added to the report, then build will just return an empty sequence. So there is no invalid state of this builder. One more important detail. It is common to return the builder from all its methods. And to do that by returning this at the end of every method. Someone might say that this design is violating the command query separation principle. In a way, you would be right if that is what you think. Mutating the object and then returning the result could confuse the caller. They might not expect mutation to happen, and that could lead to bugs. It is a very compelling reason to avoid creating mutator methods that return results. But in self-referential builders, we do expect mutation. It's not a surprise. We know that the builder is accumulating state through every call, and then we end up calling build on that. This completes the API, the public interface of one viable builder. If you remember all those requirements, it took 2 or 3 minutes for me to read them. All those requirements will be encapsulated behind these simple methods. From this point on, I will implement this builder. You will see there will be a ton of code inside of it. And the sheer complexity of that code will justify the decision to implement a separate class, a builder that will just hold that code. If you wish to see the source code for this demo, there's quite a lot of code here. The source code is available to sponsors on Patreon, so I will kindly ask you to become a sponsor of this channel. That will give you access to source code and some other goodies that are not available to regular viewers of free materials on this YouTube channel. And if you like what you are seeing in this video, you can always press the like button. That will also help others discover this video. Thank you again. Let's continue to implementation. I will do that very quickly because there will really be a lot of code and many technical decisions to make. You can pause the video and investigate every function I will write in this process. So let's begin. Delinquency is only calculated on a certain date. That is a very important aspect of this entire domain model. Everything depends on the moment when you are asking for it. This page had the same problem. That decision is solved in the factory object. Let me show you the factory. Here, it knows the date when it is used. Why not go down and let the factory create the builder with that date of its own? Have you ever seen this? Is this a builder factory design pattern? With that done, we can implement the methods on the builder. This builder, as any other builder, will accumulate state. If you were developing this application, you would know that this is the process of adding an invoice to a delinquency report for a customer. This is just correct. But now that you have this add public method on the builder, you can also expose some other public methods that will just make the caller's life easier, like add range. Now, we will follow the similar process with interest and fees. It is common for builders to store the data in nullable fields in Booleans that are initialized to null and false and then set during the builder's lifetime. That is everything we normally avoid doing with any regular object. We don't want to create objects that have missing parts in them, because somebody will invoke a method on an incomplete object and receive invalid operation exception back. But that is precisely what builders tolerate. Now, both public methods for the interest and the fee will just overwrite the field values and carry on. That's easy. There is this interesting method, include non-delinquent customers. I will leave that to your imagination. This method is also implemented in the final code that you can download from Patreon. Now, I want to focus on the build method. Most obviously, the values accumulated in that dictionary are the final report, but those objects are still missing interests and fees. We must add them. If the caller didn't request the interest, make no change. Otherwise, we must inspect the invoices before making a decision. If none of the invoices is past due, then the interest doesn't apply, even if the caller of this builder requested it. Otherwise, we must calculate the interest and append it. You don't have to read this code. You can imagine that calculating interest on multiple due dates for multiple amounts due is not so easy. So this is the expression that does that for the entire report for a single customer. Now we get on to late payments fee. We can now finally complete the build method. We do take the output item from that dictionary, but then we apply the fee, if applicable, after appending interest, if applicable. This is how much a customer owns to us, including all unpaid invoices, all interests, and notification fee, both if applied. More than 70 lines of code in that builder. But what will happen at the calling site? To produce a report, first create the builder. Then add all invoices of type unpaid invoice. Set the interest rate from the application settings in this case. Set notification fee from the settings. And build. 70 lines of code execute behind this intention-revealing expression. All I know is that there will be the sequence of customer delinquency reports, which I can turn into the UI model. Now, this is purely UI logic. It has nothing to do with the report or the domain model. And just see it printed on the screen. Let's run the application. Go to the delinquency report. Here is our friend Jake. $273 in past dues. And the interest applies to all three invoices plus the notification fee, because these $273 are long past due and we must notify Jake and ask for the money. All that piles up to $362 total. Again, a single expression. The page has no clue of complexity and the sheer number of business rules that have shaped the report it has rendered. That is the beauty and the power of the builder design pattern. So I hope that you have learned something valuable in this video. Become a patron, like this video, subscribe to my channel, and see you in the next demo.